Listener discretion is advised.
Okay, well, today I have the pleasure of speaking with Susan Hendricks, who is a news anchor for HLN and CNN, host of Weekend Express. Susan actually hosted us Wine and Crime Gals back in summer of 2019 before the world burned down at the CNN headquarters in Atlanta. That was so fun.
Oh my gosh, I loved having you on. It just, the dynamic between you guys made me want to hang out with you guys all day. And that I can't believe it was only 2019. It feels like about 5 years ago, considering what we've been through, the world has been through, right?
It's a lifetime ago. I think my favorite part was getting the news anchor hair treatment. They really, they gave me some volume.
Well, guess what? If anyone can see me now, that's what I just got. She was here at my house doing that because I don't know how to do this. And when my four-year-old son sees me, he says, "What's on your face?" Because I normally, the top looks decent, bottom, I'm still in sweats. So
exactly. Well, that is the Zoom reality of today.
Exactly.
So Susan just kind of wrapped working on a podcast called Down the Hill, The Delphi Murders, and that is a podcast about the murders of Libby German and Abby Williams in February of 2017, which as of yet, currently unsolved. So as you know, Susan, we're talking about unsolved murders, unsolved cases, and I just want to kind of get some insight from you on your experience of the kind of the pros and cons of putting these types of cases into the spotlight, like having way increased press about them, and how that can help and also hinder murder investigations. So
it was a very, Lucy, different experience for me concerning Delphi. When I first went to Delphi, Indiana, and this is way before the podcast, it was my first time there. I had reported on the news of the disappearance and the murder of the girls in 2017, February 14th, I was on the set. And because we do so much crime in so many cases, when my boss came to me and said, "Hey, we're sending you to Delphi," this was a year after the fact. I said, "Wait a minute, which one is that?" "Oh, that's the Snapchat murder," which that was called back then, where you hear, "Oh yeah, I remember that," and the voice, and okay, and landing there and being in Indiana, and then going to Delphi from Lafayette, driving there and meeting Abby and Libby's families, it was just a whole new perspective. I had been a field reporter for a long time before being an anchor at CNN. And you go out and you cover the story, you report on the story, and then it's the next day. That's the news cycle, right? Well, in Delphi, connecting with this family and really having the time to understand the crime and meeting Kelsey German, Libby's younger sister, older sister, rather, driving her to the bridge that day, the last time they saw each other. And Kelsey, by the way, is in school now studying forensics and hoping to help other families. But just being in Delphi was so different for me. And I saw the resilience, and I know that it's unsolved. But they have this drive and this, it's hard to explain. It's resilience. It's inspiring to me. It's the ability to keep going under the most horrific situations.
Yeah, I can't imagine anything more disturbing as, as a parent. I'm not a parent myself, but just the thought of having a child murdered, taken away from you, and not knowing who or how or why or having any of those answers is just heartbreaking.
I hosted a panel at CrimeCon 2019 in New Orleans. And when I first met Mike Patty, Kelsey's grandfather, she lived with them. And he said to me on stage, "Every morning I walk by and I say good morning to Libby's picture." Mm-hmm. And I said, "What keeps you going?" He said, "Thinking about the last half hour, the hour of the girls' lives. And that keeps me going. And we have to get his face out," meaning the sketch. "We have to get the word out because someone knows something." And he's waiting for that call from the authorities to say, he literally said, this is his quote, "Mike, we got him." And he's looking forward to that day. That will bring him peace. Obviously, closure is overused and you never really get it. but it brings them a bit of peace to say, you know what Libby did, the bravery of recording that voice and recording that monster's video on the bridge that day, 2017, meant something. It led to justice. That's what they're hoping for.
So do you think that specific aspect of this case, that was the Snapchat, she has just a little bit of the audio recording, a little bit of that video recording. Do you think that's sort of the primary pull that you as a journalist have in terms of wanting to bring this case into the spotlight? Because, again, somebody knows something. But on the other hand, the authorities usually want to draw a line between how much they divulge to the public and how much they're kind of, you know, keeping up their sleeves.
I think initially that is what drew us to the case when I was on the set and reporting on that, and even embarrassingly so forgot about that case a year later because there were so many cases. Once I was reminded, once I met the family, it became personal for me. I know it's not about me. I'm the journalist. It's about the family, but it really has. I've become very close to the family members. And I think that the audio and the video has driven the public to this. But then when you hear about what Libby did, hit and record, because there's more on that cell phone, not much more, but there's more. And the police will not divulge that because they said to me they don't want any false confessions. But I remember the first day I was in Delphi, the first trip, and walking into the police department. And I saw a sign that said, be careful what you say, the media could be listening. Meaning they're not saying a word. There's definitely a wall up of silence. And I understand looking into this. And Kelsey and the detectives now on the case text each other. And I speak to Kelsey often. I'll be at Crime Con with her in June in Austin, Texas, on the stage with her. And wow, is she an example of resilience, just wanting to connect and help other families and continuing to talk about this. She actually was on a live TikTok last night. I was listening in, and she was with another girl named Sarah, whose sister disappeared, and they finally made an arrest. She was murdered, sadly, 26 years after the fact there was an arrest. So they did a live TikTok, and I was listening in, and I know Kelsey, and she just said, look, I met a lot of wonderful people, survivors of the Golden State Killer, meaning family members, but she said, I'd give that all back if I could have my sister Libby back. I'd give it all back. She was thrown in the situation, and I heard this at Crime Con in New Orleans, 2019. Abby's grandmother said to me, look, Susan, it's a club you never want to be a part of. But once you are, there's a connection and a feeling within each other that you just feel and you know, and you find strength within each other.
So I would imagine that most families in situations like this, as unfortunate as they are, would take similar steps and have similar motivations to keep their cases in the spotlight, you know, try to bring as much press and attention to them as possible. Do you feel, I mean, the fact that so many people know about the Delphi case, for example, I think that has a lot to do with you and your efforts as a journalist to cover these. But for those families that don't necessarily have that spotlight and that press coverage, I mean, it seems kind of like sad and
unfair.
Very unfair that you really don't. I mean, they're such grassroots efforts, you know, like maybe families have a website or a Facebook page, you know, help find so and so. But it just there seems to be a lot of that out there. And it's just the family members that are kind of keeping those efforts going.
It is unfair. And luckily, we do have social media these days that we are able to communicate and get the word out there. But I will say, there are people in Delphi and family members that don't want to talk about this at all. And they don't want the attention that we're bringing them. And that's okay. That's their prerogative. They've been through something that I will never understand, hopefully, no matter how much I try to. So there are some family members that don't want to be as open as, let's say, Mike and Becky, who are the grandparents of Libby. They've been so welcoming to us. But I understand if someone says, you know what, I've had enough. I don't want to talk about it right now. I'm having a bad day. But in terms of the attention of the case overall, I say, hey, contact me. Direct message me. Tell me about the case. I'll cover it. Everyone deserves equal coverage if they want that. They all do, no matter what crime it is, no matter where it happened.
So kind of on the flip side of that, the interest or, and I mean, not disinterest, but just sort of those motivations, whether to get that attention or not, with the rise in popularity of so-called true crime as an entertainment medium, it seems like there are just infinite so-called armchair detectives, internet sleuths, like we've all heard, you know, the Billy Jensen, for example. Is it your hope that someone who isn't involved at all with the case will kind of consume the content that you've put out there and be able to see something that you and the authorities can't see?
Absolutely, 100%. And Kevin, who puts on CrimeCon, and my gosh, it's not easy. And gathering everyone together. And it was my first time there in New Orleans. I believe it was the third year of the event of CrimeCon. And again, it's coming up in Austin in June. Kevin also put on a crowd solve event where people came together and they brought a cold case of 30 plus years and it was solved. And Selena Gomez, believe it or not, was there with her mom because she's interested in true crime. She was. Imagine that. You're like, there's Selena Gomez and her mom.
That's
and
so
he gathered
cool.
in a room and they gave them the evidence. And, you know, I know that police departments are probably overwhelmed. And Delphi does not like the term, the authorities, their cold case, because they're constantly working on it. And it's not a derogatory term, cold case, but if it's cold, Delphi doesn't like it. I never use it there, but there are some that have gone cold. We all remember the Golden State Killer. Mm-hmm. And there were files and files that just weren't being looked at because after a while, new generations come in of officers. But there's always, right, an extra set of eyes that maybe they see something that a detective or the police department does not. Doesn't mean that they're not able to, doesn't mean they're inept. It just means that it's another set of eyes where someone may say, hey, did you ever look at this? And it obviously worked in Chicago. So I absolutely think where it crosses the line is when someone speculates, oh, I know who it is. It's John Doe. He's my neighbor, three doors down, and puts up a split screen in Delphi of the sketch. And I made up that name. Obviously, John Doe. And so Kelsey said, please don't do that because that could ruin lives. And it really can. You know, the tip line, they want your tips. They want maybe if you think you saw something that was abnormal with someone that you know, they say call in or email. Just don't put it up on social media in a split screen because it implicates someone without the evidence.
Absolutely. What are some other, well, let's stay away from the phrase cold case, but some other unsolved mysteries, unsolved murders that you kind of feel like sort of fall in line with the Delphi murders in terms of wanting to put them in the spotlight in the hopes that we can, you know, make some progress here?
Yeah, there was another case out of Iowa of two young girls last seen riding their bikes and then just disappeared out of nowhere at 1 p.m. in the afternoon. We've covered that a lot. Lyra Cook and Elizabeth Collins, age, I think, 10 and 8 at the time, and disappeared.
And they were stepsisters, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. I went to school close to where they disappeared, so I remember seeing... I mean, there were signs, missing posters all over the state for, you know, months and months and years even about those girls. Very sad.
And because it's not very heartbreaking because it's not that far from Delphi, they thought, hey, maybe there might be some connection. Mm-hmm. Nothing ever came of that. The sheriff, Tobe Lesenby in Delphi, said, no, there's no connection right now. Not saying ever. But saying right now we have not found a connection. Yeah, that unsolved case. and the parents of those two young girls, just the not knowing. And again, I spoke to Libby's grandmother, Becky, recently, and I was on a set and we did Zoom. This is about 3 months ago. And she said to me, you know what, Susan, this year's hard. I'm very happy for the girls in Libby's class, but Libby would be a senior. She'd have her own locker. She'd have her own, they get their own parking space. There were milestones that they're feeling now, 4 years after the fact, where you're happy for the other girls, but you think that should be Libby. That should be Abby. And Abby's mom, that was her only child. And I've been to the grandmother's house and I see a picture of Abby, her volleyball picture. And I'm sitting on their couch and looking at that and thinking of silence in the house and how it must have been before February 13th, 2017, and now after, and much different. And what crime does, not only to the victims, but the survivors, which are the family members, everyone around, the entire town, really, of Delphi, will never be what it was. 2,800, maybe a little more, population. And it's so different. You still see the teal and purple ribbons for Abby and Libby in honor of them, and the lights that everyone has, the orange lights on their homes in remembrance and hopefully to find justice, saying we're keeping these up until someone is finally arrested.
Well, I sure hope you liked that clip. If you did like that clip, make sure you are subscribing to our YouTube channel, leaving us a nice review, and joining us on Patreon for even more video content, audio content, salacious content all around. Come join us. Treat yourself.